Good day, class. Today we'll be discussing post 305, Foundations of Political Research, Learning Session 2. And today we'll be considering philosophical approaches in research. Research is the basis of knowledge. Research is the foundation of intellectualism. It is through research that understanding and the advancement of the frontier of progress of every society is based. Therefore, you cannot do without research. But today, we'll be looking into the approaches. What are the approaches in the study of research? We'll be looking at about three of these approaches that are interesting. One, in study one, we were able to establish what is political research, types of political research, importance of political research, and critique of political research. It was established that though political science is a science, it's not like natural science or physics, chemistry, and biology because of its subject matter, which is man. That you must not forget. In this study session, we'll be considering approaches to the study of political science research. The number one approach is traditional approach, behavioral approach, and the Marxist approach. Inter alia, let me mention what is approach. As I said in study session one, in political science, the first thing you do is to define the concept, and we call it conceptualization of concept. What is traditional approach? Approaches are methods of study of political science. Political science has a very bogus world, a bogus subject matter. Then how do I approach it? From each angle? What are the methods that I need to deploy or employ to understand politics? What are the methods that the founding fathers, the philosophers, Socrates, Plato, Aristotle deploy to understand their society? From which perspective do they view man? From which perspective was the state conceived? What are the intellectual underpinnings of research? That's what it means. So when you talk about approaches, you are talking about methods, angles, lens, perspective from which political science is being studied or political science research is being carried out. One, we talk about the traditional approach. Traditionalism, this method of investigation focuses on normative or ethical morals, issues which are hardly amenable to measurement. At the heart of this method is political phenomena dealing with matters of rights and wrongs, good and bad. These normative issues are value-laden and will differ from person to person, nations to nations, and time to time. What are we saying? Traditionalism focuses on ethics. The primary preoccupation of the founding fathers of political research was ethics. Why do men behave the way they behave? Why is our society like this? What is a state? How does the community form itself? What is the basis of man? What is the essence of existence? Why must man live in a community? As at that time, they call it polis. Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle were moving from one house to the other, asking questions about society, about ethics, about moral. What is good? What is bad? What is justice? What is equality? What is fairness? These are the major preoccupations of the philosopher. Aristotle, for example, was able to study 150 constitutions of the arts as at that time to understand natures of government. It was from Aristotle we discovered that there are various forms of government. It could be democratic, it could be military, it could be fascist, it could be traditional, it could be autocratic, it could be democratic, it could be institutionalized, it could be free society. Why? Because he took his time to study nature of association, nature of government of every country. There are characteristics of traditionalism, qualities, issues that make traditional approach unique. Number one, the traditional approach is historical in nature. Historical meaning that it relies on past events. It relies on records. It relies basically on events that has occurred in the past. Because it's traditional in nature, it's not scientific. Two, it is legalistic. Legalistic in the sense that it could not be explained. What are the norms of the people? On what basis must a woman not go out naked in the morning? What are the character of men and women of our society? What are the values of every society? Why must I not trample on my neighbor's path? These are the major preoccupations of the traditional school of thought. So number one, the traditional school of thought is historical, it's legalistic. And I told you Aristotle was able to understand this through the study of various constitutions. And that's why we have the forms of government we have today. Three, the traditional school is descriptive in nature. Descriptive in the sense that what they do then was an attempt to describe how does the society look like. And permit me to say this, lest I forget, that the traditional school of thought was the major approach that predominates the study of political science before 1920. It was the prevalent school. That was the only argument available. The only means of studying political science was traditional. Up through the 15th, the 16th century. Four, is also institutional. Plato takes his time to study the institutions that come. For you to understand Nigeria, for you to understand this country, you must understand the institutions. Then they will begin to go to the executive. How is the composition of the Nigerian executive system? That will give you an understanding of the way and manner the president will behave. What is the composition of the National Assembly? That will determine the way Nigeria will be governed. What is the composition of the judiciary? Are they being appointed or elected? Or their career men? These are institutional issues. You look at the institution of a country, from that perspective, you can study that country. And when you do that, that's traditionalism. You are adopting a traditional approach. Behavioralism. Inter alia, permit me to say this brief history. There was a history. In 1914, there's what we call WW1, which is World War I. The war broke. It was man in humanity to man. The entire Earth's surface was engulfed in crisis. And the damage was colossal. By 1919, the student of political science then came together and said, come, we cannot condemn ourselves. The world must not destroy itself. We must fashion a way out of this problem. Something is fundamentally wrong. Then the League of Nations was bettered. The establishment of the League of Nations was to establish a world of freedom and peace. A society where man will respect each other. Where nations will respect one another. A society of independence and sovereignty. But unfortunately, by 1939, the world had another war. And that's what we call WW2. The Second World War ushered in what we call behavioralism today. The aftermath of the Second World War was damaging. Man in humanity to man. Man was destroying himself. Nigeria participated in the Second World War. Nations were against nations. Anti-ballistic missiles were tested. If you have gone through history, you know the history of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, where America tested the bomb. See, today the generations are dwarfs. It did not end there. The aftermath of the Second World War was now make the student of political science from Ohio University, Chicago University, Michigan University to come together and say, come, something is wrong with the way and manner we study politics. Because it's the responsibility of the political scientists of that time and of this generation to provide solution. For example, if Nigeria is backward today, if Nigeria is not progressing today, if our nation does not have a direction today, it is a failure of the political scientists, both students and scholars. Therefore, it was the duty of the political scientists to provide a solution, to create a window, an outlet, a new way of thinking. We call it a paradigm shift. It was a redirection of the entire system. Therefore, United Nations was established in 1945. The essence of establishing United Nations was to tell you, come, we will not fight again. We are going to drop our weapon. Whatever is our grievances, let us have a body that we all respect, where we all surrender our sovereignty, and whatever decision is decided becomes the order of the day. Behavioralism fundamentally was to study man, the characters of the major actors in the Second World War need to be studied. Why is Hitler thinking the way he's thinking? What prepared Hitler? Adolf Hitler imagined he can rule the world. He was seeing a world he's going to dominate. Germany was advancing. USSR was on top. Therefore, there's a need to study the character, the attitude of individual. And that's what we mean by behavioralism. The behavior, the conduct of individual leaders has a long impact on the character, the attitude of that nation. It then means that if Nigeria is not developing today, the behavior of our leaders has gone a long way in not making us to develop. So behavioralism was a new thinking. It was the only way out. It was a new science. We call it a paradigm shift in political science. So the behavioral movement gained popularity in the 1920s because of the inability of the traditional school to explain some global phenomenon. It's a creative of the traditional school. The behavioral led that new method could be developed to help political science formulate empirical propositions and theories of a systematic sort. For example, Robert Dye, in 1969, Truman, 1951, were preoccupied with the scientific procedures of observation, verification, quantification of data. Truman, 1951, recommended that a political scientist should carry out his research in quantitative time, if he can, and in qualitative time, if you must. The behavioral school of thought is systematic, is empirical, is scientific. And that was why political science got that name, science. Initially, before the behavioral school, it was the study of politics. There was nothing like political science. The science you are seeing there was ushered in by the behavioral school. That come, we can study political science scientifically. Or we can study politics scientifically. We can also investigate. We can make inquiry. We can gather data. We can analyze data. We can sort data. We can also make predictions on character of men. They could behave, they could predict that come. If Gaddafi continued the way he's going, it's dangerous for Africa. They could predict the Sani Abacha of Nigeria scientifically based on the content of his character. So the scientific study of political science began with behavioralism as a new thinking, Marxist approach. Behavioralism and traditionalism are founded on the epistemology of liberal social science scholarship. Marxism on the radical social science scholarship, he emphasizes on social change, though in a more profound manner, and also places emphasis on class and class analysis. Marx's argument is known as historical materialism or dialectic materialism. One, it is historical because it's concerned with historical causation and laws of society. What Marx does, Karl Marx, is dialectic materialism was to give a history of the world. How does the society metamorphose? What has been the relationship between the classes in society? He called it class and class analysis. Between the feuders and the lords, the serfs and their landowners, owners of means of production and owners of labor, the proletariat and the bourgeoisies. So what Karl Marx did, in summary, was to look into the history of the world and see what relationship exists in production. What relationship exists between the employee and the employer? How much is the employee producing? And what are his gains or his benefits or rewards from the employer? Are they commensurate? The excess production, how is she being shared? These are the relationships that Karl Marx look into. But he mixed both the behavioral elements and the traditional elements to form Marxism. And that's what we call the Marxist approach today. Marxism is therefore a political science philosophical method or class that combines both value judgments and scientific procedures to conduct political investigations and demand for a revolutionary change in the society. Ladies and gentlemen, this study session has been able to give you an understanding of the foundations of political research, especially as it relates to the approaches. And earlier I mentioned there are three major approaches. You have the traditional approach, you have the Marxist approach, and you have the behavioral approach, which is scientific, which is systematic, which is empirical in nature.